Hey everybody, last week I was alluding to something called slice analysis, slice-by-slice analysis, and it's not that widely used. I don't see it in a ton of fMRI papers, but it's something I've used in a recent study of mine. I think it's pretty useful. I think it's a really good way to get a more nuanced understanding about some of the contrasts you're looking at and how they play out in, say, posterior to anterior fashion, ventral to dorsal, whatever you want, really. So basically, the upshot of all of it is that you can see how the contrasts change as a function of position. So maybe, you know, one of them starts really high back here, the other one starts pretty low back there, and maybe they cross, there's some kind of interaction, maybe there's like a mean effect of one over the other, you know, something like that. It's just a cool way to look a little bit more closely at the data and also maybe get a sense of how everything is interacting with each other. So just to show you a quick example, this is one paper that I've seen it in. This is by Derek Nee, Sabine Castor, and Josh Brown. This was published a few years ago. But what you see here is the t-statistics on the y-axis, and then looking at these three different conditions, like conflict effects, switch effects, error effects, across the brain in both the z-direction and also the y-direction. So you can see that, you know, it gives you some more information than just looking at the contrast in itself. You can see how it plays out over all these different slices. So to show you some code snippets, how to, you know, get this to work for yourself if you're interested in doing something like that. This is actually an adaptation of one of John Ashburner's scripts that he put up online, or I think somebody put up as part of their correspondence with them. If you think I made this thing by myself, you're insane, because man, there's no way I would have the time or the talent to do that. So I'm going to post this online. I think it should be pretty not too difficult to change for yourself. I kind of wanted to hold off on making it a function because that might be a little bit difficult. But here's the code. But first, what I want to show you before you actually get into it is, what are you going to use for a mask? Okay, so what we saw in the previous paper, there was a certain region, you know, how you define that. You can make it an anatomical mask, that's always an option, or you can make it, say, some kind of unbiased mask that's defined functionally. Okay, in this case, in this particular example, I'm looking at surprisingly, you know, painful events and surprising stroop events, you know, based on something you predicted, some cue gave you a certain prediction, and it was violated. Like, the outcome was not what you expected, you know, the probability was flipped or something like that. So what I just want to show you here is, so in this case, this is the mask I'm using. It's a main effect across both pain surprise and stroop surprise, you know, collapsing across modality, just looking at surprise. So this is just a visual of what it looks like. I've just, you know, used that ROI, loaded it up, set the p-value to 1. These are all the voxels that are activated, okay? So that's what I'm using for my stroop surprise mask, and then a similar process for my pain surprise mask. And how I got those, not to get too far off the beaten path, but I just multiplied that stroop surprise contrast map across the whole brain and multiplied it by that binary mask, you know, collapsing across both stroop surprise and pain surprise. So if you're cool with that, if you have any questions about that, you can just, you know, send me a quick email or something, but that's how I got it. That's what I'm extracting. Okay, so in this case, you know, I have a certain amount of subjects, and, you know, I've made some adaptations to this. The basic structure is John Ashburner's again. I made some changes to it, but what it's going to do is it's going to look across the entire masks, the entire ROI, and it's going to tabulate all of the contrasts. Okay, in this case, I'm using contrasts, not t-statistics, just to make the whole, you know, interaction test, mean effects test, a little bit more valid. Okay, so the most important parts here are that it's going to dump all this stuff. It's going to sort this according to a particular direction. In this case, I'm looking in the Z direction, so posterior to anterior in an fMRI image. Okay, you could change this number right here to 1 if you wanted the X direction, say like left to right, or Z if you wanted ventral to dorsal, anything like that. And then it sorts that, okay, according to that, and we're going to be taking the mean across, you know, for each slice. You know, there's a certain number of voxels activated in that mask for each slice. We're going to average across all of those for each slice, okay? So that's what it's going to look like. Again, if we want to look at some of the guts about how this is happening, if I you know, run this thing. Let me see here. So this is getVoxelStats is what I call it. You know, you can copy paste it, just have whatever you want. But so this XYZ stats thing right here. Okay, if you look at it, I've sorted it according to row, or sorry, column 2, which is this guy right here. Yeah. So what you'll notice is that since each slice is 2 millimeters thick, it's going to be increasing in increments of 2. Alright, so just be aware of how you resample this, because you know, I'm assuming everybody resamples to a similar template, a 2x2x2 resolution, but it's going to look for this guy right here. It's going to be averaging across all of those. Then it's going to look for everything that has 4, so only, you know, within the 4 millimeter slice. Sorry, the one that's 4 millimeters anterior to the origin. Okay, it's going to average across all of these guys for that, and then average across all of these guys for number 6. Yeah, it's going to keep doing that. And at the end of the day, what I'm going to find is an average for both, you know, that Stroop surprise contrast, yeah, and also the Pain surprise contrast as well. Okay, I've only done it for 2 subjects, so each column is 1 subject. So this is for subject 1, whoever put in there, and this is the averaging across that first slice and the second slice, third slice, and so on. The same thing for the second person. And I can do it across all of my different subjects. So I'm going to post this code online. I hope it's pretty self-explanatory. Then I'll just show you briefly in another tutorial how to import that into R to actually carry out some interaction test.